She lives now among the nations. She finds no resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her in the midst of her distress. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate, her priests groan, her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters, her enemies prosper, because the Lord has made her suffer for the multitude of her transgressions. Her children have gone away, captives before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princes have become like stags that find no pastures. They fled without strength before the pursuer. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue to read Psalm 137, responsibly. By the waters of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered you, O Zion.
As for us, we hung among the trees in the midst of the land.
For those who led us away captive asked us for a song, and our oppressors called for mirth. Sing us one of the songs of Zion.
How shall we sing the Lord's song upon our native soil?
If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill.
Let my tongue lead to the roof of my mouth, for I do not remember you. If I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy.
Remember the day of Jerusalem, O Lord, against the people of Edom, who said, down with it, even to the ground.
O daughter of Babylon, give you his instruction, and happy the one who pays you back for what you have done to us.
Happy shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock. God of courage and compassion, comfort the exile from oppressed, strengthen the faith of your people, and bring us all to our true home, the kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did. When I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day, recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I'm sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed then of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel and the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. And this grace has been given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but has been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard the deposit I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. The Lord replied, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this marble tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, come here at once and take your place at the table? Would you not rather say to him, prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink? Later you may eat and drink. Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. We praise you, O Lord, and we thank you for your blessed word. If only I had more faith, I could do so much more. If only another translation of this passage says, give us more faith. Faith and obedience, also a duty to Christ, are what we are called to. Today's gospel lesson stresses the importance of both, not the quantity, but true fundamental faith, humility in the sight of God. The disciples of Jesus are concerned. They have worked, listened to their Lord, tried to follow his precepts. Yet they feel that it is not enough. They want more from him, not from themselves, but from him. He is to do more for them. But Jesus startles his disciples by telling them that they already have enough to follow him. Instead of listening to them, he uses the surprising metaphor of a mustard seed. He says, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. They were probably wondering, maybe we are, maybe not, what he is talking about. And he just keeps piling it on. He uses the image of a slave. This translation has slave. Another biblical one is servanthood. So a slave is in the fields, working all day. He comes into the house around dinner time, and he expects to be fed. No, the master tells him that he has to prepare supper, put on an apron, give the master food and drink, and then he can serve himself. We can imagine the scene. A person is working in the fields all day. He is hot, tired, completely exhausted. Yet his work isn't done yet. He has to obey. It is not he who can give orders. He has to obey them. So we come to obedience and humility. We are called in faith, so small it would seem, as tiny as a mustard seed, and then summoned to obedience and duty. This is not a treatise to support of slavery, as one commentator has suggested, and doesn't, I think, have to be explained. The Danish theologian Kierkegaard once wrote, it is hard to believe, not because it is hard to understand, but because it is hard to obey. So Jesus is teaching quite a serious lesson. Just before this metaphor of the mustard seed, he is asked about forgiveness. How many times is a person to forgive someone who has wronged him or her, slighted and injured them? So how many times? Once, twice, seven times? He says, if he sins against you seven times in one day, and says that he is sorry each time, forgive him. That is certainly a lot of forgiving. I certainly know how difficult it can be at times to forgive, yet how easy once this teaching is applied. How many times? Just keep doing it. Our two congregations have continued the Zoom series on great thinkers of the past. It has been an opportunity to consider people like Hildegard of Bingen, Teresa of Avila, Francis of Assisi, Bede of the 18th century, and Henry Nouwen of the 20th. Teresa of Avila has a famous metaphor of the mustard seed, peppercorns growing out of mulberry leaves, silkworms weaving their magic and creating beautiful silk cocoons. Yet the metaphor for this 16th century Spanish religious and saint is much more. Observing the intricate workings of nature, the laborious patience of the silkworm, and the silk beauty that is created, Teresa sees it as representing the soul, and she writes, "The silkworm is like the soul which takes life when through the best which comes from the Holy Spirit, it begins to utilize the general help which God gives to us all and to make use of the remedies which he left in his church, such as frequent confessions, good books, and sermons." She goes on to speak of the real life of the soul. We can neither subtract from nor add to God, but we can subtract from and add to ourselves just as these little silkworms do. And before we have finished doing all that we can in that respect, God will take this tiny achievement of ours, which is nothing at all, unite it with his greatness, and give it such worth that its reward will be the Lord himself. That is Teresa. But John in his gospel writes that he has chosen us, not we have chosen him. "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another." The biblical scholar, Craddock, speaking of this Lucan text, says it is not a reprimand for the absence of faith, but an affirmation to live fully with all the possibilities that it can entail. He goes on to say that it lays hold of God, with whom nothing is impossible. God empowers the life of his disciples then and now. So you see that God has given us enough. He has already done it for us in his amazing, unsurpassable grace. We, as the disciples, have more than we need if only we can realize it. The Jerome commentary suggests that the disciples need more deepening of faith. It is their responsibility, their duty, just as it is ours. It is God who bestows his grace, his graciousness. In our Bible book club, we were reading just recently Paul's letter to the Colossians, and speaking about the fact that despite everything, despite all we've gone through, that God, in the Spirit of Christ, is with us, holding, strengthening us, being with us. But what a powerful statement Paul is saying in his second letter to Timothy, his beloved child. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus. Look what he writes to him, encouraging Timothy. "For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline." It's as if St. Paul is speaking to us today.
Join with me in suffering for the gospel, in the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. And this grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. God's promises hold true as they always have. We heard Lamentations today, and what an outpouring of grief. How lonely sits the city that was full of people. She lives now among the nations. She finds no resting place. But then there are these words of promise. My compassion never fails. Great is thy faithfulness. Our faith does not change the circumstances of life. Despite all that is going on, the incessant floods, the hurricanes on the East Coast, Cuba, the Dominican Republic, and now what terrible scenes, what a reality, terrible reality we're seeing in Florida. The continuing war in Ukraine, forced conscription in Russia, thousands trying to flee, lines of cars backed up, annexation, illegal annexation, so much, and we wonder about it all. So what do? Faith, this faith as small as a mustard seed, is the way by which we can approach and live our lives. The author and preacher, David Jeremiah, spoke about how he wanted to change the world some 10 years ago, change the world. Speaking to an audience of several hundred, he confessed that now he wanted to change just one person. The problems of the world were just too big. And maybe that's how this faith, this beautiful gift of God that we have been given, as St. Paul writes in his first letter to the Corinthians. He speaks about the diversities of gifts, so many gifts, but this great gift of faith by the same Spirit. There are losses, but there are also opportunities. God has never left us. He keeps calling, inviting, maybe not the kind of obedience and duty that we see in today's lesson, that of a slave or a servant, but nevertheless a response, our responsibility. And again, St. Paul says it so well. The life which I have in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and delivered himself up for me. When our focus is centered on the mercy and faithfulness of God, then we have enough and more than enough. Amen. We continue with the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Pondering the relationship between our duties to God and our duties as citizens, let us pray for ourselves and the world, responding to the words, Lord, in your prayer with, Lord, have mercy with you. hear our prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, open our hearts to you, guide our minds, fill our imaginations, and control our will so that we may be totally yours. Use us as you will, always to your glory and the welfare of your people. Direct us, Lord, in all our actions, so that with your continuing help, we may be a credit to your name. Through our Lord and Savior, we pray, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, our Lord God of our salvation, it is your will that all people might come to you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Inspire our witness to him, that all may know the power of his forgiveness and the hope of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, send the light of your truth into all the earth. Inspire faithful women and men to spread the gospel, both at home and in distant lands. Give your wisdom and grace to all clergy who serve you in his church, so that by their diligent service, faith may grow and your kingdom increase. We pray especially today for Bishop Andrew, Bishop Kevin, Reverend Jeanette, Father David, Deacon Grace, Reverend Anita, and Pastor Evans. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you created all people in your image. We thank you for the astonishing variety of races and cultures in this world. We celebrate this diversity here in this very congregation, as well as in our neighborhoods. Enrich our lives by ever-widening circles of friendship, and show us your presence in those who differ most from us. But at this time of the year, we must acknowledge the difficult relationship between the Aboriginal peoples of Canada and the settlers of this land. Help our society to acknowledge the harm that has been done to our Indigenous peoples and to work towards reconciliation with them. Grant spiritual and bodily healing to our Indigenous peoples, despite the often still difficult circumstances in which they live. We pray, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, keep our nation under your care. Bless the leaders of our land so that we may be a people at peace amongst ourselves and a blessing to other nations. Help us elect trustworthy leaders who were able to make wise decisions for our general welfare. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for those affected by war and civil conflict in so very many parts of the world. We pray especially for all affected by the ongoing and brutal conflict in the Ukraine. We ask that you show a pathway to peace before this war progresses to even greater destruction to both the population of the area and its property. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, in giving us dominion over the earth, you gave us also responsibility for managing your creation. However, we have failed miserably in doing so. The natural disasters attributed to climate change increase with each year, while any measures to alleviate the damage being done to the environment continue to be inadequate. Increase our commitment to take the necessary measures to remedy the situation. We acknowledge that this will inevitably result and noticeable changes to our comfortable lifestyles. We pray for all victims of natural disasters, specifically those whose lives have been shattered by Hurricane Fiona in recent days. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, their homes, and their livelihoods. Lord, comfort them and provide them with the strength to begin the enormous task of rebuilding their lives. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious God, comfort all who suffer in body and mind. Give them the strength and patience to endure their suffering. Restore them to wellness according to your will. Today we pray for Joyce, Roy and Helen, Allison, Sharon and Terry, Simonese, Marg, Barnabas, Carla and John, Lester and Iris, Claire, Samantha, Helen, and Phyllis. We pray also for those who have placed requests in our prayer mailbox, specifically Marilyn, Betsy, and Luis Halanone, who is being unjustly targeted by the government of the Philippines for being a terrorist. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who have died, especially Stephen Schubert and Andy, and any others who we may now name aloud or silently. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. For all your goodness and love revealed to us in this house of sanctuary and worship, we praise you and we thank you, O God. Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dear God, you number our hairs and determine our days. You hang the stars and feed the sparrows. You open the doors no one can shut and shut doors no one can open. Help us to trust you as we make some serious and important decisions for this, your church is in part of us. God, we know we are not alone. We will trust you for generous wisdom, straight paths, or at least paths where we can grow and learn while taking them, as well as for peaceful hearts. All for your glory. We will plan, but we trust you to order our steps. Please help us to fulfill our vision as stated in our mission statement, to love and worship God together through Christian fellowship and service to your community. Amen.
Thank you.
Make us worthy servants, strong to follow in the pattern of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
suffers for the sick and the rejected, betrayed and forsaken, he did not strike back, but overcame hatred with love. On the cross, he defeated the power of sin and death by raising him from the dead. You show us the power of your love to bring new life to all your people.
Glory to you, Lord.
On the night before he gave up his life for us, Jesus, at supper with his friends, took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which is shed for you and for many, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me."
Glory to you forever and ever.
Gracious God, with this bread and wine, we celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus, and we offer ourselves to you in him. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that we may know the presence of Jesus in the breaking of bread, and share in the life of the family of your children.
Glory to you.
Father, you call us to be your servants. Fill us with the courage and love of Jesus, that all the world may gather in joy at the table of your kingdom. We sing your praise, Almighty Father, through Jesus our Lord, in the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Glory to you.
Thank you. our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all, and we have some announcements.
On behalf of the Lake Pastoral Visitors, I'd just like to thank all of you who made the tea such a success yesterday afternoon. We had lots of food and fellowship and a lovely hymn sing, and there were 18 people in attendance. So thank you all very much from the bottom of our hearts.
Good morning. As many of you know, on Saturday, November the 5th, is our Christmas market. I am in charge of the bake table, which is a very successful table at the Christmas market. I, of course, need baked goods to sell. So if you are interested in baking for the bake table, I have an information sheet which explains what it's all about and what we would like to have available to sell. So if you're interested, please see me. I'll be at the back of the church. And we look forward to seeing you on November the 5th. Thank you.
Good morning. It's Thanksgiving next week, believe it or not. So we haven't been able to do this for the last couple of years, but we are asking for donations of fruits and vegetables. There's a list in the in your bulletin if you take note of it. And we will be receiving these donations on Saturday morning between 10:30 and 11:30 at our east door, this door right over here. We'll be receiving the donations and we're going to put them out in the church. Then afterwards, we're going to collect them all back up and we're sending them to Kennedy House. Thank you.
Worship with you. I can say the services have quite some liturgy, so but in any case, to appreciate the formality of your services. And so many people to thank today. So first of all, I want to thank my colleague, Deacon Grace. Thank you. And Fiona, co-organist here. And Teresa, for reading, a lot of reading today. Choir for your beautiful music, Edward for his reading, Ivers for his song translation, Jane who was here to meet us, and Helen, you have the coffee. Did I remember everybody? And to all of you, big thanks. So we finish with the closing hymn, Now Thank We All Know.